last session of the day. To chair this session, I would like to call on stage Dr. Antony Otis Beria, Dr. Satish Khadalikar, and Dr. Vinod Puri. Dr. Otis Beria, as you already know, is head Summer School of Myology in Paris, France. Dr. Vinod Puri is a senior neurologist, Max Super Specialty Hospital, Saket, New Delhi. And Dr. Khadalikar is a senior neurologist at Breach Candy Trust Hospital, New Delhi, in Mumbai.
So, we welcome you to the last session of this meeting. And the first speaker is Harsh Patel. He is a young neurologist in Department of Pediatrics, Zydus Hospital, Ahmedabad. Harsh.
Good afternoon, all of you. Thank you very much, Shefali ma'am, and entire organizing team, NeuroPedagogy 2018, for giving me this opportunity. My talk is on electrophysiology study, mainly the practical tips for the clinician. Here the electrophysiological study will limit to the nerve conduction study and the electromyography. Now why we need it? What is the utility of electrophysiological studies? Usually it's an extension of the clinical examination and the clinical history what we gain from the patients, and it has to be curtailed according to the patient need. So we have to individualize each and every patient for the same. It helps us to confirmation and the localization, either we are dealing primary with the nerve disorder or the muscle disorder. It helps us the determining the and the distribution of the disease in the nerve and the muscle, either it is more the proximal involvement or the distal involvement. It also helps us to determine the severity and also the extent, especially in the motor nerve disorders, motor neuron disorders. And it also helps us to identify the pathophysiologic process which is undergoing, especially at the either primary axonal loss or the demyelinating, or if there is a sign of reinnervation or the denervation, which is specifically very helpful when we are dealing with the obstetric Ous palsy cases. And in a very rare situations, it also help us to monitoring the recovery and also the treatment effect what we are giving to our patients. Now, broadly, practical tips can be divided into these two spectrum. Either we want to interpret the study results or we want to perform the study. Because on the interest of time, I just limit to the interpret the study result, which is more clinically relevant in our day-to-day practice. First of all, how to interpret the nerve conduction studies. So we just look at the very brief what it means and what the parameters we want to look at and how the disease patterns, primary axonal loss or the demyelinating, that parameters are get changed. In the simplest term, nerve conduction study is just we want to stimulate the studying nerve, the what which nerve we want to study, usually the peripheral nerves, and we want to record that potential. The potential can be recorded directly from the nerve, especially in the sensory nerve conduction studies, or it can be recorded from the muscle, mainly in the motor nerve conduction studies. NCS of the proximal structures is very technically challenging, so we did an indirect study in the form of FA and the H reflexes. Now, this is the recording technique. Here in the demo, we are demonstrating the ulnar nerve, which is the abductor digiti minimi. And there are the two electrodes which are the recording, the G1 and the G2. And the nearest one, the more the proximal is the G1, always should be placed. And whenever you are stimulating the nerve, the anode, the cathode should be facing towards the G1. And these are the three parameters we want to look at, that is the distal latency, CMAP, that is the amplitude, and the velocity. As we know in the physics, velocity, we need the distance and the time. So we also measures the distance between the two stimulation, as we do in the graph shows, that is a distal near the wrist and at the elbow. So we measure that distance, and then we decide, then we derive the conduction velocity. So the conduction velocity is the derived value, while the other two are the measured value. In the sensory nerve conduction study, we directly measure from the nerve, and usually the G1, G2 distance should be kept ideally between 3 to 4 centimeter. If we keep it too narrow, the phase cancellation reduce the snap values, that is action potential value, and if it is to keep too far, that also increases the latency. So ideal distance should be maintained. That is one of the important technical factor. Usually the nerve we are studying in the upper limb are the median and the ulnar, in the both the motor and the sensory. And some days, especially in dealing with the obstetric brachial nerve palsy, we also studied the higher nerves at the ops point, that are the biceps and the tricep muscles supplying. In the lower limb, we usually go for motor studies are the tibial and the peroneal. And the sensory, we usually study the sural and the superficial peroneal nerves. Now, what we mean by a CMAP, that is a motor action potential, compound motor action potential, why we call it the compound? Because it includes the nerve action potential, that all the fibers, whatever the generating the amount, that are all accumulated. It also consider electrophysiological consideration of the neuromuscular transmission and also the muscle action potential. Hence, it is always in the large amplitude that measures in the millivolt. As we see, it's a summation of all the potentials what we are getting into the consideration. While in contrast to the compound muscle action potential, sensory nerve action potential is the just the measurement of, we can say, the fastest and the heaviest myelinated fiber. So there is a phrase we call as a phase acceleration. So whenever you are stimulating the nerve, suppose the nerve has a 10 fibers, so which is the fastest and the heavy myelinated, that considers, and the rest of the others are coming late, they are getting the cancellated. So we the summated potentials are very low, measures in the micro world. So whenever you are studying the sensory nerve conduction studies, that there has to be keep a thing that we have to keep the noise cancellation ratio very low, because it affects the surrounding structures, affect the very importantly, and we are getting the false results. So here is the graphical value of the same. While the F wave is basically reflects the pure motor pathway, it is not a purely synaptic or the stretch reflex. It has the afferent and the efferent limb. It is just measure the firing of the gamma motor neurons. And usually we did a 10 stimuli, and then we measure the F wave value in terms of latency and the persistence. While the H reflex is a truly reflex, it measures include the both the thing, that is the afferent and the efferent value. And it is a true physiologic, electrophysiologic, we can say, the reflex, and it's a surrogate marker of the ankle reflex. The patterns what we are dealing are the axonal loss, which includes the mainly are the potential loss, that is the reduced amplitude of snap and CMAP, as we see in this diagram. While the demyelination is the mainly the prolongation of the latency and the reduced values of the conduction velocity. So here we can see in this diagram, there is a conduction velocity is very low. This is the main difference between the two pathogenic physiologic process. Axonal loss, the most and the affected thing are the CMAP and the SNAP, while in the demyelination, most affected parameters are the distal latencies and the conduction velocities. And another important point are the conduction block and the temporal dispersion, which specially indicate towards the acquired etiology. We'll see in this thing. Basically, conduction block, what we mean in the very simplest term, there is a difference between the distal and the proximal CMAP values. So basically, that suggests the surrogate marker of the focal or the patchy demyelination. So there is a difference of roughly around, say, 50% of the value between the distal and the proximal one. Proximal is less than the distal one, so we call it as a conduction block. The same thing is the temporal dispersion, which is a desynchronization. So when there is a negative peak duration between the distal and the proximal one, if there is an increase in the 30% between the distal and the proximal, then we call it as a temporal dispersion. This also suggests there is not a uniform, it's a patchy focal demyelination, which is a very surrogate marker of the acquired etiology, mainly we see in AIDP variant of the GBS. So here it is depicted in the same way. We are shortly going to this case, and then we finished it. We have a 4-year-old girl who is born to a non-consanguineous marriage, second in birth order. And she presented with the subacute progressive asymmetric weakness. The left is more than the right, and the lower limb is more affected. No other canine lung involvement. On examination, she has areflexia. Other rest of the history was normal. So it was referred by the treating team as acute polyneuropathy and just referred for the NCV. So when I read the NCV, then I recall the patients and I again examine the another two findings which we got as that she has appendicular hypertonia. The grade is 1 to 2 on the modified ESSWA scale and she has extensor plantar neosforms. So that is very highly suggestive of pyramidal tract involvement. And why we need to do this? Because this is the what we get in the NCV. It is there is no conduction block, no temporal dispersion, and very uniform, suggestive of very uniform demyelination. There is also involvement of the axonal, but the primary we can see the conduction velocity is just 29. And the same thing we can also see is a very uniform demyelination. And when you get this is very highly suggestive of inherited etiology. So we went ahead, we get the MRI scan done, and then we see there is a deep white matter involvement. The important thing is there is a corpus callosum sparing, so this is a leukodystrophy. Usually the age favors the MLD, but the corpus callosum sparing with this much white matter involvement, so we go ahead with the testing of the Krebs also, and we found this enzyme deficiency, so it turned out to be the late infantile onset Krebs disease. I'll just skip the RNST, and this is the my summary slide. So the EPS is the extension of the clinical examination. We has to be tailored to the clinical diagnostic consideration and interpreted in the same way. The patterns of the EPS changes are the base considered to anticipate, not the underlying, not to define, because it required the biopsy, obviously. And the many technical factors which has to be considered are the temperature of the limbs when you are studying. The ideal temperature for the upper limb is 32 and the lower limb is 30. And you also, the base thing, you have to good the grounding also, and the soundproof room is the ideal situation we can do it, because in the intensive care setup there are many other electrical instruments which can disturb the results also. So all these factors has to be taken into the considerations. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Any question? Harsh, I have one comment.
Yes, sir.
This slide which you showed before, the TB now, mm-hmm. which a dispersion pattern was there, that signifies the multifocal involvement. That show multifocal demyelination is there.
Okay.
When there's uniform demyelination, you don't find dispersion pattern.
Huh.
Right? So the slide was showed that you showed the uniform. No, it was not uniform. It was multifocal.
Okay. But there was no dispersions or?
It was showing many waves are coming at that area, no? First one. Just before the TB now.
Okay.
When you find multiple, it means multifocal.
Okay.
Fine. Right? Fine, good. It's a good study.
Thank you,
Harsh. Fine. Next talk is the algorithm approach to suspecting muscle dystrophies. This is by Gurmeet Kocher. He's a senior pediatric neurologist at SPS Hospital, Ludhiana. Gurmeet. Fine.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Shikali ma'am, for inviting me. So, So my talk is on algorithmic approach to suspected muscular dystrophy. So when do you suspect? The first step is to suspect muscular dystrophy. So yesterday we heard Professor Shevel talk about screening and surveillance for motor delays. So in 2013, there was a report from American Academy of Pediatrics, which gave algorithmic approach to motor delay, how to identify and how to evaluate the motor delays in children. So according to that report, so you have to do surveillance in every healthy visit. When the child is not rolling over by 6 months, the child is not sitting by 9 months of age, he's not walking by 18 months of age, he's not running by 24 months, and he cannot stand from sitting position without support by 18 months of age. So this is the time when you should suspect a muscular dystrophy. You should do CPK test and do further evaluation. So message is, any motor delay, get CPK level done. Muscular dystrophy is easier than neuropathies to suspect because it is mostly associated with higher CPKs. So the first part of the algorithm is, whenever there is a motor delay or the symptoms of muscle weakness, get a CPK level done. If the CPK is normal, think of other things. If there is areflexia, distal weakness, atrophy, sensory symptoms, you think of neuropathy, not muscular disease. If there is ocular or bulbar involvement, think of neuromuscular junction disease or myasthenia. And if there is proximal and distal weakness with a lot of wasting and fasciculation, think of spinal muscular atrophy or anterior horn cell disease. When the CPK is raised, then think of proximal muscle weakness or myopathy. So to summarize, insidious onset, gradually progressive muscle weakness with normal sensory examination, it signifies myopathy. Myopathy can be hereditary and acquired. And acquired myopathies again can be of various types, congenital myopathies which are mostly non-progressive with only mildly raised CPK levels. Muscular dystrophies are quite high CPK levels. Myotonia, channelopathies, they present with myotonia. And then there are other disorders like metabolic, Pompe's disease and mitochondrial, which are also important causes of hereditary myopathies. But we'll be talking about muscular dystrophies. I'll be taking few cases. The first next step after suspecting muscular dystrophy and there is high CPK, then you have to look for the pattern of the weakness. That what are the symptoms of the muscle disease? What are the are there any positive symptoms like cramps, myalgias, or are there any myoglobinuria or anything? And then second most important is age of onset. If the onset is at birth or in early infancy, you'll think of congenital muscular dystrophies or congenital myopathies or congenital myasthenic syndromes. And if the onset is late, we'll think of other muscular dystrophies, which we will discuss. And then, very importantly, progression and what with what rate the disease is progressing. Suppose there is acute, subacute onset of muscle disease and rapidly progressing, it could be inflammatory myopathy and not a muscular dystrophy. So third point is family history. So very, very important. Many diseases are X-linked, like Emery-Dreifuss and Duchenne muscular dystrophy and BMD, they are X-linked. And LGMD can be either autosomal recessive and dominant. And next is the distribution of weakness. There's a very beautiful article by Professor Kadilkar, which you can read on PubMed if you are interested, because lack of time, we cannot discuss everything here. So this is a first case, the prototype muscular dystrophy, which we all see, is a four-year-old child with difficulty in climbing stairs and getting up from the floor. The onset was 2 years. It is a progressive disease with a similar disease in maternal uncle with this phenotype. There is a typical calf hypertrophy, the valley sign. The valley sign is, this is a hypertrophied deltoid and infraspinatus and the valley formed by the anterior axillary fold muscles which are atrophied. And third is Gower sign, which is positive. So if this is positive clinically, your diagnosis is Duchenne muscular dystrophy. So you get a CPK level done, which is 200 times, 50 to 200 times the normal, and peak about 2 to 3 years of age and then decline. Many quacks, they make fool of people by giving some medicine which will decrease CPK. Remember, CPK is not correlated with the severity of the disease. And it is also increased in about 50% of the carriers. And if the CPK is raised, earlier we used to do so many muscle biopsies, but now it is replaced by DMD gene deletion by MLPA, which has been discussed. It is positive in around 70% of the cases. If MLPA is negative, we go for NGS because it's a large gene. And if no mutation is found, DMD is very unlikely. So this is the next phenotype, the pattern of weakness. The child is having facial weakness. Just see the blank facies. And the fish, look at the atrophy of the humeral muscles and the scapular overriding of the scapula. So periscapular muscles are weak. So face, scapulohumeral, these three areas are involved. So this is called as facioscapulohumeral dystrophy, which presents in adolescence, has an autosomal dominant inheritance. It presents with weakness of shoulder girdle and facial weakness. And the prominent point is asymmetry. There's asymmetry of the asymmetric winging of the scapula, and this is another family of facioscapulohumeral dystrophy. Then there are a few other muscle dystrophies which can present with facial weakness, like congenital myopathy, congenital muscular dystrophy. So we have to discern the pattern of the muscle disease. So to summarize, in children, based on age of onset, family history, distribution of weakness, establish a clinical pattern. For example, typical DMD, go for MLPA. If it is negative, go for NGS. Limb girdle pattern, which is, suppose a female child presents with this phenotype of DMD, but so it is not X-linked, so think of LGMD. We have to go for genetic studies or muscle biopsy if genetic studies are negative. If it's adolescence or so dominant weakness, facioscapulohumeral dystrophy, we can go for genetic studies, but they are very difficult, as Professor Anthony told, that it's a repeat sequence which is very difficult to establish. If there is myotonic dystrophy pattern, autosomal dominant weakness, distal weakness predominantly with wasting and myotonia, think of myotonic dystrophy. In this, everything will be negative. Other than if you don't go for CTG repeats, your NGS and muscle biopsy will, may not help. So we have to know the clinical pattern before sending the tests. Another case is a four-year-old boy who presented with motor delay, and the birth history also was suggestive of hypotonia, respiratory difficulties. He had myopathic phases, mild ptosis, and he had contractures of elbows and knees with hyperlaxity of joints. So proximal weakness was there. CPK was only mildly raised, and the child was having progressive weakness. So it is not congenital myopathy. He progressed and lost his ambulation at 5 years. This is typical of congenital muscular dystrophy, hyperlaxity of joints, and prominent calcanea, a soft velvety skin. So this phenotype, if it is a hyperlaxity phenotype, think of congenital muscular dystrophy. So if there is hypotonia at birth, weakness, and joint contractures, the differentials are congenital muscular dystrophy and myopathy. So the progressive nature in this disease and joint laxity favor CMD, the collagen ones. In this case, NGS revealed mutation is collagen gene. So congenital muscular dystrophies, to summarize, they are of three types, three or four types. One is collagenopathies, which I just showed. Ulrich is a severe phenotype and Bethlem is a milder one. Then are myosinopathies. Myosinopathies are the muscular dystrophy which also present with global developmental delay. They have white matter changes in MRI. So in myosinopathies and dystroglycanopathies, MRI help. So if there is a child with hypotonia and muscle weakness from birth and has seizures and other things, so you have to go for MRI brain. And there are some others. So I think this is the last case, 6-year-old female who presents with motor delay followed by regression and frequent falls, consanguineous marriage, SIP death at 3 years, and there is calf hypertrophy, Gower sign positive and very high CPK. So again a DMD phenotype, but she is a girl, so this is not X-linked. It's either most likely autosomal recessive as there is a history of SIP death. So what are the differentials? LGMD. Sarcoglycanopathies in children, they commonly present with DMD phenotype, and dystroglycanopathies, one of the congenital muscular dystrophies. In this child, there was mutation in FKRP gene, homozygous mutation. So this becomes congenital muscular dystrophy, dystroglycanopathies with brain and eye abnormalities. These are the differentials. So this is type 2I LGMD. So to summarize, the congenital ones, the progressive weakness in an infant, if it is an early onset weakness with congenital contractures, a joint hyperlaxity, associated intellectual disability, seizures, and raised CPK, do examine the parents for myotonia and myasthenia and get an MRI brain. If there is a laxity phenotype, which we just discussed, think of collagen-related disease. If there is weakness, distal contractures, seizures, and MRI shows white matter changes, think of myosinopathies or laminin-related diseases. And if there is mental retardation and severe problems in MRI, like listen carefully, cobblestone appearance, pachygyria, and ocular abnormalities, think of syndromic dystroglycanopathies like Fukuyama muscle disease and muscle eye brain disease and Walker-Warburg syndrome. And if there is LGMD or BMD phenotype, milder ones with calf hypertrophy, just think of dystroglycanopathies like the fifth case I showed you. So, take-home messages are that get CPK levels in any child with motor delay or muscle weakness. Suspect muscular dystrophy if there is chronic progressive weakness with raised CPK. Establish the clinical pattern based on symptoms, age of onset, family history, distribution of weakness and muscle atrophy. MLPA testing is almost the first test in confirmatory, and muscle biopsy is helpful if the genetic is non-conclusive or negative, because NGS is positive only in 50% of the cases, as we heard earlier. Thank you.
Thank you. For the sake of time, we have to move on to the next speaker. Okay, so I would like to call Professor Nalini from Nimhans, Bangalore, Professor of Neurology, former head of Department of Neurology, and she's going to talk about algorithmic approach to suspected neuropathies. Please.
I need your help. Thank you, Dr. Shefali, for inviting me and giving me the opportunity to share. Although neuropathy is not my cup of tea, but I'll try to do my best here. muscle and neuromuscular junctions are. Rene, aap kya kar diya? No, go back, go back. Haan, 14. So I'm just going to, I think somebody needs to help me. Yeah. Okay. So I'm just going to start with our experience with biopsies. This was between 1999 to 2008. You see that a time when we were really doing multiple biopsies, and for every other case with neuropathy, be it acquired or degenerative, biopsies was a common investigation. But now we have dramatically reduced on that with the advent of the genetic studies and also with MR neurography and more elaborate nerve conduction studies and more high-end equipments which are available now. So you see that even with this experience, we see that hereditary causes for neuropathy are more common among the pediatric population than as we see in the adults. So you see that the inflammatory myopathies, neuropathies are only about 12% of the large series that was seen over 10 years and the biopsy confirmed patients. So we know that biopsy is most useful in demyelinating and inflammatory neuropathies. When do we consider a biopsy? What is more important is that a clinical phenotyping of the patient is very, very essential, and following which we can decide whether the patient has acquired or degenerative neuropathy. And so we have a few of the genetic experience. We see that the peripheral neuropathy with mitochondrial mutations, point mutations were seen in about 11%, the SERF1, the POLG, and most of these patients had axonal neuropathy as per the electrophysiology. So recently we have our genetic conditions. We know that the HS3TC2 is the commonest autosomal recessive Charcot-Marie tooth, and we've had it in about 3 cases, mitofusin 2 in about 2 cases, GDAP in 1, which is the autosomal recessive form of the Charcot-Marie tooth, and the PLEC-HG5 also, which is a recessive form. And these are very rare ones, but we were identified. So first and foremost, when do we suspect a neuropathy? We should know that the components of a neuropathy can be motor, it can be sensory, and it can be autonomic. I've just tried to detail what are the classical features. So one has to first in the clinic consider that this child has a neuropathy and not like a distal myopathy or muscle weakness. So usually sometimes there can be a pure motor weakness, and we may have difficulty in considering whether the patient has a neuropathy or not. So electrophysiology comes in very handy. I'm not going to go into the details. So what is important is a careful history taking, physical examination. As I said, phenotypic characterization is extremely crucial. Electrodiagnostic study, extensive ones, including proximal conductions, very, very important. And then we consider molecular genetic studies, followed by sural nerve biopsy, only when we consider that there is an overlap between acquired and degenerative neuropathy. We can go ahead with metabolic laboratory studies when there are systemic disorders. So at times we do nerve biopsy when the hereditary neuropathies are more common in children, when a CIDP is suspected, and when it looks like a inherited neuropathy. So what are the 6 key questions that we ask? Whether the motor, sensory, autonomic or combination is present, whether it is only distal or proximal. We know that acquired neuropathies evolve and quickly it involves the proximal and the distal muscles, and whether it is pure motor, pure sensory, and whether there is any associated upper motor neuron involvement, which tells us that it may be a systemic disorder with neuropathy associated. And what's the temporal evolution, whether it is acute, subacute, or chronic. And very carefully, we need to take family history for neuropathy, examine the siblings, and also examine the parents. And at times, we have to do nerve conductions of the siblings and the parents to confirm whether the patient has an inherited neuropathy when in doubt. So ask for simple history, like whether the child has a funny feet, unevenly worn out shoes, clumsiness in motor activities, spine deformities and foot deformities, which are important clues to long-standing illness. And we also need to examine the relatives. So physical examination is very, very important. You see that foot drop may be identified by a doctor and never appreciated by the child or the parents. And high arched foot, hammer toe, and other physical conditions. So I think the time is really very less, and I need to go ahead with the thing. So how do we differentiate between acquired and hereditary type of neuropathies? So usually you have an acute to subacute onset. Remissions and exacerbations may be there. positive sensory symptoms, which is uncommon in hereditary neuropathies. Usually you may have an inflammatory demyelinating type of neuropathy, a positive family history in hereditary, and patients can have some bulbar symptoms and cranial neuropathy more common in the acquired, unlike in the hereditary where it is mostly the limb onset and response to appropriate therapy and no response to specific therapy. Some autonomic symptoms should also be asked in these patients. So there are some peripheral markers, as I have mentioned here, look for angiokeratomas, orange tonsils, anosmia and Refsum's disease and vitamin B12 deficiencies and evidence of carpal tunnel syndrome and mucopolysaccharidosis. So this is a patient with orange tonsils, you can see corneal clouding. So these are peripheral signs that one need to look, and you may have spotters in peripheral neuropathy. Examine the patient carefully, look for peripheral neuropathy signs, look for motor symptoms and sensory symptoms. Usually it is in a glove and stocking distribution in most of these conditions. But the evolution of the disease is very, very important to know whether it is acquired or degenerative form. So electrodiagnosis has already been mentioned, very, very careful. You have to do even proximal conductions and all segments of the upper limb and the lower limb to look for multifocal demyelination. Whereas in hereditary, usually you will have uniform demyelinating features, and in acquired, you will have multifocal demyelination. So investigations, routine investigations, as well as advanced. I'm not going to go into these things. So recently, we have a lot of advances in MR neurography, and you can see that the sciatic nerves, which are very well, the sciatic nerves, the very well seen in advanced. This is 3 Tesla MR neurography, and this is normal. Sometimes it's very important, and we can differentiate between Charcot-Marie tooth, where there is uniform thickening, whereas in CIDP, there can be multifocal thickening, as is seen in this patient. So this is a brachial plexus. You can see the normal, the plexus, how it looks. These are the nerves, which are well seen, but you can see the very thick and hyper-intense nerves in the Charcot-Marie tooth type 1A. So when in doubt, we can look into this MR neurography, which may give us a clue between acquired and degenerative, and also when these nerves are thickened uniformly and non-uniformly. So nerve biopsy now has almost no role in the evaluation of a patient with CMT. Clinical suspicion is very, very important, and should be reserved only for complex patients referred to tertiary neuromuscular disorders clinic. And we know that genetic rapidly advancing field, technology advances and the cost falls, and we can do whole exam today, which is quite affordable, and mass sequencing for all genes can be done. So just a few cases with CMT, look at the abnormal feet. The first patient does not have much of wasting, so the cousin, but look at the hands, which are very severely wasted. So this is the patient, 2 cousins with CMT2B and CMT4A, predominantly a demyelinating type of neuropathy, but still this patient, you can see that has got Peschewitz abnormalities, but not much of wasting as you see in axonopathy. So this is one of the conditions where you have CMT4B, which are autosomal recessive disorders, and this patient has got early glaucoma. So CMT with glaucoma, you can make a diagnosis of CMT4B. And if you're using targeted panels, so your clinical phenotype has to be perfect, and then you can go ahead and, that light can be put off. Go ahead and make a diagnosis and ask for targeted panels. So another patient, very important, that childhood neuropathies, you have hereditary neuropathies which are more common, and look at the deformities, the Peschewitz, the wasting of the hand, and the kyphoscoliosis. Very common, as soon as you see these patients, you can make an easy diagnosis of Charcot-Marie tooth, demyelinating forms, and axonal forms, as you can see, both the foot and the hand deformities that are seen. So hereditary sensory autonomic neuropathies, you can see these are inadvertent injuries that the patient has. The tongue can be involved. And look at the non-healing ulcers. Sometimes if a patient is 10 or 11 years, this can, particularly without cranial nerve involvement, you can think of Hansen's disease. We had patients who are 9 and 10 years old with Hansen's disease confirmed and who also had nerve abscesses. So hereditary sensory autonomic neuropathy in India many a times is diagnosed as Hansen's, and for several years the patients keep taking Hansen's treatment. Actually, this I wanted to show, that these patients would have seen pediatricians when they were young and might have missed out, but these are adult patients when you can see the irreversible and the severe damage that has happened to these patients when in the adult time. So this child was mitofusin 2. It's very difficult to make out a difference between the various forms of axonal forms of Charcot-Marie tooth. And this patient, you can see the distal wasting in the upper limbs and in the lower limbs with almost an inverted champagne bottle appearance. And this was a confirmed case of mitofusin 2. And this child had a GDAP1 CMT2K, which is an axonal form. Looks similar, but when we do genetics, we know that the mutations are different, but the phenotypes are similar. So it can be vice versa, when the genetic abnormalities can be different and the phenotypes can be the same. So this is a case of confirmed giant axonal neuropathy. I'm just going to show the classical one where you have this negroid type of hair and you can have prominent eyelashes, prominent, let's say. So let me just go to the, so when you have an inherited neuropathy, you have to think of axonal or demyelinating form and you do the detailed electrophysiological studies and you can go for NGS. So sometimes it's a pure neuropathy. You look at the various conditions. A neuropathy can be a part of the multisystem disorders. So part of a syndrome complex or presenting feature of a multisystem disorder. So you have various conditions which I have listed out. It would be difficult to go through this. And if it's a case of CIDP also, you can evaluate the patient. But most of the CIDP suspected in childhood would have turned out to be hereditary motor neuropathies of the demyelinating type. So I think with this short time, I was able to tell some things, yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Rambanandri, Professor Nalini. That was great.
I think we go on to the fourth presentation. The role of neuropathology in neuromuscular disorders. Professor M.C. Sharma.
Why not?
No.
M.C. Sharma. No. M.C. Sharma is the one. He has to go somewhere.
I think.
Okay, parents. Joint hyperextensibility. By and large, floppy infant refers to a hypotonic infant. So when coming to approach to a floppy infant, we should remember that the most common cause of a floppy child is not neuromuscular, actually. It's more of CNS pathologies. That's like a cerebral palsy in the hypotonic phase or genetic disorders, mostly chromosomal disorders like Down syndrome. They are the more common causes than the peripheral causes. Coming to newborns, the most common cause of a hypotonic newborn is the acute illness, like that is systemic illness. So the assessment of infants, hypotonic infants, should start with the general health evaluation. So a hypotonic infant may not come to you in your practice as a, like, my child is having floppiness. They may come with various complaints, like mother having polyhydramnios, decreased intrauterine movements, hypotonic infant presenting as birth asphyxia, poor suck, weak cry, decreased movements. They may have recurrent pneumonia. And one of the most important presentation of a floppy child is delayed motor milestones. And on examination, clues like hip dislocation, they may come as arthrogryposis, decreased spontaneous movements, frog-like posture. Because of the the posture, they may have flat occipital loss of air. They may have chest deformities like pectus excavatum, facial dysmorphism, and you will also find delay in motor milestones in the examination. So they may not come to you as with the complaint of floppiness. They may come to you with any of these complaints. So the basic approach for me is, as usual, we will have a detailed history, then examination, then we frame a clinical diagnosis. From the clinical diagnosis, we have to form a hypothesis and debate whether this floppiness is because of central hypotonia, or is it peripheral hypotonia, or is it a mixed picture? Central hypotonia refers to cerebral or spinal causes. Peripheral hypotonia means starting from anterior horn cell till liver muscle. If the features are mixed, it becomes mixed hypotonia. Once you have hypothesis like, is it central, peripheral, mixed, you go for the appropriate investigations and you confirm it either by genetics or some other methods. So these are some of the common causes of cerebral central hypotonia. Most common being chromosomal disorders like Down syndrome, Prader-Willi syndrome, even hypoxic incel, they go through a phase of hypotonic CP, lysosomal storage disorder like GM1 gangliosidosis. Pompe has both central as well as peripheral features. Not to forget paroxysomal disorders like Zellweger syndrome. Peripheral, we have discussed so far, like starting from anterior horn cell till the muscle. In the anterior horn cells, spinal muscular atrophy is the most important. In the nerve, neuropathies, which are both hereditary as well as congenital, neuromuscular, we know myasthenia and botulism. In muscle, it can be either myopathy or muscular dystrophy. So this we have to emphasize that some of the causes may be having mixed features. Like they may have poor muscle strength, like poor anti-gravity movement, but reflexes may be brisk, or they have poor reflexes of the strong, floppy strong. So some of the causes of mixed hypertonia are familial dysautonomia, HIE, INAD, that is infantile neuroaxonal degeneration, lipid storage disorders, mitochondrial diseases, because both they have both peripheral neuropathy as well as encephalopathy, they may have mixed features. Sometimes perinatal asphyxia, which presents a central hypotonia, can be because of a muscle pathology or motor unit pathology. So they can also have mixed features. So in the history, the most important points are whether they are present at birth or present later, or it is static or progressive. And this we all know, like, so I'm just skipping the most other aspects of history. So on the examination, we should look at the head circumference, dysmorphic features, look for myopathic features, look for high arch palate, the typical myopathic faces, ptosis, undescended testis. We do 180 degree examination as a, for every kid, starting from prone position to the supine position, and we do various maneuvers. The one of the most important sign is Foster sign, where we do on ventral suspension, you just tickle the baby's foot. If the baby is able to lift the limb above the level of the pelvis, that is means it's central hypotonia. If he is not able to lift, that means peripheral hypotonia. That's an important clue. And on examination, we obviously do the detailed examination, but never miss two important signs, that is looking at the tongue of an infant by showing a torch, that is to look for fasciculations, which are seen in SME. So you can show a twitching or scintillation of the tongue. The other important feature which is seen in type 2 or type 3 SMA is a small amplitude jerky movements of the hands or fingers, which is called polymyny myoclonus, which is also, these two are key features of anterior horn cell involvement. So some of the features are never miss noticing the posture. The child should be alert, not crying. Also take gestation into account. Look for dysmorphism and look for cry. A weak cry may be in diaphragmatic weakness, fatigable cry in myasthenic syndromes. So once you have done this, this is my key slide. Like once you have done this, tablet these features and differentiate between central and peripheral. For example, in central hypotonia, strength, that is power is good, anti-gravity movements are good. Your deep tendon reflex are either normal or they are brisk. Babinski plantar is extensor. Primitive reflexes, Moro reflexes are persistent. Fasciculations are not seen. Muscle mass may be normal or there may be disuse atrophy. In anterior horn cell, the power is weak, that is a floppy, weak child. Two key features are areflexia and proximal atrophy and fasciculations. In peripheral nerve, distal atrophy, absent reflexes. In neuromuscular junction, fatigable weakness, you may have a normal reflexia to hyporeflexia. In muscle, hyporeflexic to the strength of the muscle is decreased, and the muscle mass may be decreased. So this we skip some examples. This is a 1 year old infant, born as IUGR, had feeding difficulty, but became obese because of voracious appetite. She has significant hypotonia. Anybody, what is the diagnosis? This is Prader-Willi syndrome. This child had abnormal facial features, flat facial features, recurrent seizures. MRI showed some features of cerebral dysgenesis and renal cysts. Anybody, fast. What? No, renal cyst, cerebral dysgenesis, flat facial profile, Zellweger syndrome. This baby presented with floppy floppiness, and on just lifting the, you find inverted nipples, that is because of this, and cerebellar hypopression, the MRI. So, sir has already discussed this thing. So, this is another baby, ventilator dependent, from birth. So, in the mother, you find myotonia. So this is congenital myotonic dystrophy. You can see the typical tinted upper lip. Okay, so this is the algorithm to how to approach a child with floppy child. So have a detailed history and examination. After that, you on the basis of history, if you find features suggestive of central, like abduntation, seizures, global delay, on examination, you get features like hyperactive DTRs, it's confirmed, central hypotonia. So you look into the causes of central hypotonia, like depending on the individual case, you may order neuroimaging, EEG, or acute pathologies like infections. If you are thinking of direct chromosomal, you can go for a chromosomal studies. So that will be central. If you find features like hypotonia, weakness, areflexia, fasciculations, weak cry, weak suck, external ophthalmoplegia, arthrogryphosis, but with the alert faces, like a typical SMA, you will think of lower motor neuron pathology. So for every lower motor neuron, CPK is a basic step. If the CPK is normal, it can be either myopathy or neuropathy or NMJ. If CPK is elevated, it is muscular dystrophy. So depending on that, we will order further investigations like a muscle biopsy or nerve biopsy, then we can go for genetic confirmation. But in a major chunk, you may not find a clear cut, is it a central or peripheral? So you have to go for a multidisciplinary approach where we have to get a genetic consultation, detailed evaluation, where you may have to go for genetic studies depending on the individual case. Like in Prader-Willi, you will have to do sometimes like methylation studies or FISH studies and then come to a diagnosis. So just a last side, having done the basic review of how to approach, just by doing good detailed physical examination history alone, we will be able to diagnose 50% of cases. Like our neuromuscular evaluation, the yield is only 6%. So even after doing extensive workup, neuromuscular or CNS evaluation, you may not be able to find the etiology in all cases. Around 10% may still remain undiagnosed. You may get clues and further follow-up when they come on the follow-up. So that's the, around 7% you may not get at the first visit. That's all. Thank you very much. I would like to thank our teacher, Professor Shefali Gulati, for giving this opportunity.
Thank you. Any question? Thank you. It was a wonderful talk. Hi.
Thanks.
Thank you. You see, next talk is in the role of neuropathology, neuromuscular disorders, algorithmic approach by no one less than Dr. M.C. Sharma. He's a very renowned figure in the field of neuropathology and established many of the algorithms. Dr. M.C. Sharma.
Thank you, sir. I am thankful to Professor Shefali Gulati and her team for giving me this opportunity to talk upon this topic. After the lecture of by Professor Andoni on the NGS, I think the role of neuropathologist has become redundant, and most of the features he discussed. But still, if you are doing the muscle biopsy, there are two parts: one in the interpretation, diagnosis, the other the processing. This is the ideal situation. If you look at the muscle biopsy, from the first look, one has to decide whether it is a neurogenic, it is a myopathic, it is a metabolic, or it is congenital myopathy. And to get such a good result, you need a very good processing. The large number of people are involved, starting from the resident who is doing the muscle biopsy, from the transportation, the defreezing or quenching in the laboratory. And if you want to get such results, all these steps are must. And based on the first look, we have to decide what, in which way to go, whether be to the histochemistry, immunohistochemistry, immunoblotting, electron microscopy, or the genetic studies. Because based on this, if you burn muscle biopsy for the histochemistry, and you find that is some more of the metabolic or the mitochondrial myopathy, glycogen storage disorder, then the electron microscopy is more useful. So that is the importance of deciding. And I must say that never accept for the pathologist, but for the clinician, never send the muscle biopsy where facilities are not available fully. Muscle biopsy is painful. I must say that it should be a good biopsy. But I must say that muscle biopsy painful means the pain is a relative term sometimes. For example, the genetic analysis in the Medscape, I think MedGenome, they are charging 35,000 for whole genome sequencing. And muscle biopsy is less painful for a poor person. But one must consider that muscle biopsy is painful. And a lot of precaution has to be taken. Sometimes the muscle biopsy is taken near the tendon. It looks like the muscular dystrophy near the fascia, sometime at the needle site, sometime at the injection site, or sometime if you are asking the surgeon to do the muscle biopsy, invariably he will put in the 10% formalin. He will not listen to anyone. Mm-hmm. So muscle biopsy has to be sent fresh, and in the end, if you're not fixing properly, you get a lot of artifacts. And in the lab, there are different ways of transportation in the liquid nitrogen. Sometime if you're sending to a distance, it may be the liquid nitrogen with the dry ice. In the lab, we divide muscle biopsy in three parts. The most important part is the defreezing in the isopentane. That is the most important. And sometimes, despite all the best efforts, you get a lot of artifacts. Muscle biopsies are difficult to interpret. And you know that then you realize that the next-gen sequencing is better than the muscle biopsy. The muscle diseases, they are classified, and the recent WHO, they try to classify based on the defects. But I think it is also not very good classification. And the first, earlier we used to think that there's only one condition which is treatable. We should diagnose immediately the dermatomyositis in children or polymyositis in adults. But the list is increasing. Today we heard another disease which are also treatable. So this is the case of dermatomyositis. There is a perivascular atrophy. The muscle fiber in the periphery are atrophied. And there is blood vessels are thickened. It is more of vasculopathies. And the MSC class 1, there's an infiltration of the CD4, CD3, and 20 cells. And sometimes you have to do the electron microscopy. This shows the granular deposit on the endothelial cells. They are the membrane attack complex or the activated complement, which can be demonstrated by electron microscopy. In case of glycogen storage disorder or the mitochondrial disorder, you have to do the other stain. One is the glycogen PAS stain, then electron microscopy. You have to demonstrate the membrane bound glycogens in the muscles. So EM is more helpful. This is a very classical example of mitochondrial myopathy, where even the HND, you find a lot of bluish fiber, coxin active fibers, and the ragged red fibers. And the EM shows very classical inclusions, which are zipper-like, some are paracrystalline, some are parking lot, or the fingerprint-like. So those all can be diagnosed. The previous speaker, he spoke about the floppy infant. In children, most of the diseases, I think in 25% of the cases, the diagnosis is something else, because there is a congenital myopathy, muscular dystrophy, myopathy, neurogenic, they all present in a similar way. So whatever is the cause in neurogenic, this is the group atrophy, which is the most important feature, which can be demonstrated sometime. There is maybe this SMA type 3, there is a muscular dystrophy-like feature also. CPK may also be high, this calf hypertrophy may be there. And congenital myopathy, the large number of diseases. This is one example. I must say that NGS will be better for the diagnosis of these muscular myopathies, because changes in the congenital myopathy are similar. For example, the Nimenol rod disease, you have the same type of changes, but there are large number of genes which are affected. So ultimately, you have to resort to the gene analysis, central core disease, multi-core disease, zebra body, cap disease, because the histopathology, the changes are similar. For example, the central core disease, they are the well-formed cores. In the Nimenol rod, they are rod-like structures. In the central nuclei, the nuclei are in the center. But large number of genes are different, which are mutated. Sometimes some of the diseases, which can be laminopathy, the amyotrophies, they can all be diagnosed on the muscle biopsy. But the best thing about the muscular dystrophy is, you know the gene which is defected, you know the protein, and the antibody is available. So one can do the immunohistochemistry for all these myosinopathy. The myosin is inactive here. The collagen 6 disease, which can also be diagnosed on the skin biopsy, where the collagen 6 can be negative. And the Ullrich, Bethlem myopathies, the selenoprotein, they all can be diagnosed based on the antibodies. DMD, we are not getting nowadays DMD specimen, because you are resorting to the gene analysis. But DMD, sometime we used to get when they to decide between the backers and DMD. But nowadays, that also is more of clinical. But I mean, 30% of the cases which are not picked up by the genetic studies, the muscle biopsies are done. It may be all three antibodies may be absent labeling, or it may be one of them, or maybe two of them. And for the backers, this patchy staining. For the carriers, this is the group of fiber which is positive. Some fibers are inactive. Limb girdle, the most common in our country is calpinopathy, followed by dysplanopathy and sarcoglycanopathy. In children, sarcoglycanopathies are most common, and we can do the immunohistochemistry. If one is absent, you can pinpoint that this gene is defective, mutated. But sometimes all these are negative. In those situations, it is difficult based on the histopathology to decide whether which gene is affected. So in these situations, either immunoblot or the sequencing is indicated. For the calpinopathy, sometimes these lobulated fibers on histochemistry, they are very useful. One can do the immunoblot. This band is absent. In dysplanopathy, immunohistochemistry is available. Immunoblot can help. The lastly, I don't know the how to, Dr. Anthony can tell me how to remember the chart of this limb girdle muscular dystrophy. The number of genes is increasing every day. Is there any way to remember in clinical practice? And Dr. Sefali and Dr. Vishwajit, they are doing a lot of skin biopsies as alternative to the muscle biopsy. In many situations, they are very helpful, but all diseases cannot be diagnosed by the skin biopsy. But still, there are some diseases where the muscle biopsy, skin biopsy is helpful. And I am thankful to my team as well as Dr. Andoni, Dr. H.H. Google from Germany, who generated some interest in muscle diseases. But in the end, I will say that muscle biopsy and NGS, they should be complementary to each other. In the muscle biopsy, we can decrease the possibilities, and then one can go for the sequencing. But I'm sure time is changing. In the next 5 to 10 years, in India, every third lab will have the NGS, but the only problem is the data interpretation. Otherwise, cost has become, will not be that much problem. So muscle biopsy, the same is happening in pathology. First we are doing the immunohistochemistry. Then when we see the morphology, we find that this was a classical case of this disease. Same is going to happen in the muscle. First you do the, people will do the NGS, and the 20% he said is, they are not diagnosed with NGS, or sometime there was a case with the ECTA1 mutation in the NGS in Dr. Shefali or case, but clinically not very severely affected. And there are no changes in the muscle. So in those situations, I think there should be some correlation between the morphology and the sequencing. Thank you. I was young or?
Thanks a lot, Professor Sharma. I think the message is that we still need pathologists and good expert muscle pathologists. Just as you said, when you have tricky situations, and the second time, because sometimes we need to validate the variants, and for that we need muscle pathology. And I don't know in India, but in France, the number of pathologists is just going down.
I think one of the unfortunate things are in our country is, in your country, the myopathology is at the peak level. It has developed very well, but here it is dying before it has attained the height. There are hardly very few centers who are doing the myopathology. Muscle pathology is not done everywhere. That's it.
Thank you. And then we move on to the next speaker, who is Manisha Jana, Associate Professor at Ames. Yeah, she's coming. And she's going to talk about the role of imaging in neuromuscular disorders. How do we do that?
So, good afternoon to you all. This should be a brief talk. Of course, role of imaging is not that much elaborate in these group of disorders. Many of them have been already discussed that where is the importance of imaging here. So neuromuscular disorder, it's a group. So it encompasses the anterior horn cell disorders, peripheral nerves disorders, neuromuscular junction, and the muscle disorder. So four groups at all. And not all of them are, not all of the disorders we need to do imaging. So a brief chart of all of them. This anterior horn cell group, in the childhood group, spinal muscular atrophy is the most important group. And how is imaging required here? For SMA, imaging is usually not indicated for diagnosis. So you can diagnose it. There is molecular testing available. Clinically, you can diagnose it. So imaging is not crucial for making a diagnosis. But if you do a muscle MRI, which is upcoming field, you can see a typical pattern of muscle involvement in specific groups, group 1, SMA type 1, 2, 3. They show varied appearances of selective muscle involvement and selective sparing. I'll show them later. Coming to the nerve, peripheral neuropathies. In the neuropathy group, where is the importance of imaging lies? So if you are suspecting a GB syndrome, imaging is required in, it is required to exclude other diagnosis, not to establish a diagnosis which is often established clinically in electrophysiology. If we do MR, we can see anterior nerve root enhancement. As has been already discussed earlier in CMT and CIDP, the typical appearance of the nerve enlargement can be shown by MRI in typically MR neurography. For the neuromuscular junction disorders, of course, imaging is not required for making a diagnosis. If we are thinking myasthenia gravis, then you should look for a thymus, for any abnormality in the thymus. For the muscle synallopathies, there is a whole lot of group of disorders. You cannot make a diagnosis on imaging. So radiological imaging is usually not essential for diagnosis. But it has been said in few articles that in the non-dystrophic myotonias, imaging may show hyperintense central stripe in the medial gastrocnemius muscle, especially in the myotonia congenita. Although this is not an established fact, there are reports of this. Then muscle MRI has been shown to be important in cases of response assessment in muscle MRI, although we have very limited experience in these specific muscle MRI group, but this is an upcoming area of imaging. Coming to the disorder of muscles. So if you are thinking about muscular dystrophy, there are a whole lot of group of disorders in muscular dystrophy. In this group of autosomal recessive disorders, in the congenital muscular dystrophy group, there is an importance of imaging, especially in the brain as well as the muscle MR. So the congenital muscular dystrophy is a heterogeneous group of disorder, which can be associated or may not be associated with abnormal CNS imaging findings. In these cases, you can, if the clinically you are suspecting a CMD, then you should order an brain MR imaging. So the types can be pure CMD, Fukuyama, Muscle-Eye brain, or Wacker-Wurtburg. So how the imaging varies in all these groups? I'll show examples. So in imaging in CMD, it has got two prongs. One is brain MR and muscle MR or USC. Muscle MR and USC, they are upcoming field. They are not that readily available or readily done. But brain MR is crucial. So this is a slide taken from this article in Ajainan, what is an old article. And it shows how the imaging neuroimaging findings vary in the CMDs, different CMDs, starting from Fukuyama, Muscle-Eye brain, and Wacker-Wurtburg. It's in a spectrum. The severest form is seen in Wacker-Wurtburg, and the mild form is POCMD and Fukuyama. So what are the imaging findings if you're thinking about cerebral cortex findings? In the cortex, you can see migrational anomalies in the form of lissencephaly or cobblestone brain. This under sulcation, the gyri are thick, and then there is one hyperintense stripe, and below that there is yet another gray matter stripe over here. So this is a cobblestone cortex. Again, here in the frontal cortex, you can see there are undersulcation and there are polymicrogyric pattern as well. Associated with that, you can see that there is abnormal white matter signal intensity. They are all associated with CMDs. So here we can see frontal cortex as well as white matter abnormalities. In the cerebellar involvement, what we can see is that there are multiple cerebellar cysts. This is a normal for comparison. The normal cerebellar fovea should be visible like this. But here we can see that normal cerebellar fovea differentiation is completely lost. It is a dysplastic appearance. And there are multiple cysts, T1 hypo and T2 hyperintense signal. Also, we can see there is inferior vermis hypoplasia as compared to a normal scan, white matter signal abnormality of the temporal pole, and brainstem hypoplasia. Again, yet another case with cerebellar cysts and dysplastic cerebellum. Cerebellar involvement also here in the sagittal section, we can see there is inferior vermis hypoplasia. Brainstem involvement can come in the form of a hypoplastic pons, hypoplastic brainstem, as it's seen, like this is a normal belly of the pons, which is hypoplastic over here, and it is seen like a flat belly of the pons, and the colliculi are fused. As we can see here, the superior inferior colliculi are separately seen. Here we cannot see the superior or inferior colliculi. So there is a fused colliculi over here. So these are the CNS imaging findings. In muscular dystrophies, muscle imaging can be done using ultrasound, CT, and MRI. Of course, CT in children is not a feasible option because of the radiation issues involved. Ultrasound is subjective, although it is very useful in cases of targeted muscle biopsies. MRI, in muscle MRI, how do you do? Usually, you can do a whole body MR imaging or a targeted MR imaging of the group of muscle involvement. However, whole body MR is obviously better because it can map which areas are preferentially involved. The imaging, the key sequences are T1 weighted images and star images. So the role of muscle MRI is the identification and quantification of the muscle changes. There is a good, there is a score involved, although this is not clinically required to quantify the muscle involvement. But if you are putting the child under some treatment, it can be used as a surrogate marker for monitoring treatment. So you are doing T1 and star-rotated images. Normal signal is, all of us are aware. But if it's hyper-intense on star and T1 weighted images show normal, so that means it's a muscle edema, it is an early phase. But if there is fatty replacement, it will be hyper-intense on T1 weighted images. So that is a later stage of muscle involvement, which shows fatty replacement. This is not my image, but it shows a case of SMA, where we can see that the normal muscle signal intensity should be like this. Here the muscles had been replaced by signal which is similar to the subcutaneous fat. So there is fatty replacement of muscle with selective sparing of this middle muscle. So once you have spotted abnormal signal on muscle MR, you should look for the extent of involvement and selective or relative sparing of some muscle involvement, because that can give you some clue of what the diagnosis can be. So there are a few slides, but this is too extensive. Like in muscle MRI in SMA can show you few typical types of involvement. Like in SMA type 1, you can see almost all the thigh and calf muscles show ragged kind of atrophy. But as we go to type 2 and type 3, they're relatively milder. In type 2, you can get a relative sparing of adductor muscles, adductor longus. Similarly, DMD, already diagnosis is made, and the muscle MRI is not indicated to make a diagnosis. So the take-home message is that in neuromuscular disorder, it's a heterogeneous group of disorder. Not in all of them, imaging is indicated. Brain MRI is indicated in cases of suspected CMDs, and muscle MRI is an upcoming field and may be promising in cases of treatment monitoring. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. think that brings us to the last talk of this session. Algorithmic approach to acute flaccid paralysis. Vishwaroop Chakraborty. He's a pediatric neurologist working as assistant professor at the AIIMS.
Okay. So, as part of the organizing team, I would just like to thank the people who are waiting till late in the evening so that we can, you know, at least finish it off fast. So, approach to acute flaccid paralysis. So, we start with the definition. So, it's a clinical syndrome which is characterized by rapid onset of limb weakness, which at times is accompanied by bulbar and respiratory muscle weakness. There has been no fixed duration cited in the literature for rapidity of evolution or progression of clinical features to nadir. It's usually mentioned in days to weeks for the simple reason that this has got epidemiological relevance so that we don't miss out on any case of polio. This looks like a crowded slide, but basically the message that we want to give is, in terms of anatomical site localization, all the sites are involved in a case of acute flaccid paralysis, starting from anterior horn cell to dorsal root ganglia, spinal cord, radicals and peripheral nerves, neuromuscle junction, and muscle. And what happens is, the ones which are bold are the ones which are common and we should not be missing out. So polio for anterior horn cell, herpes and rabies for dorsal root ganglia, transverse myelitis and trauma for spinal cord. This group has more common causes like Guillain-Barré syndrome, CIDP, diphtheria, rabies, tick bite, heavy metals, then other chemicals, critical illness, hypokalemic periodic paralysis. Then we have neuromuscle junction, which has things like myasthenic crisis, organophosphorus poisoning, and then we have muscle, which includes some of the systemic causes as well as polymyositis. Now, these three slides actually summarizes the entire clinico-topographical features that is seen with acute flaccid paralysis. So the first two slides are the ones which shows the ones which have rapid progression, which includes GBS. If you see, the onset is rapid, lasts for around 2 to 4 weeks. It is symmetric, ascending, generalized, may have cranial neuropathy and sometimes respiratory weakness. DTRs are not elicitable. Sensory features may be present, may not be present. Bladder and bowel involvement is occasional. Fever may or may not be present. Meningeal signs are occasionally seen. And preceding prodromal illness or vaccination may be seen in up to 70%. Next, we have transverse myelitis. Again, the onset is rapid, the progression is rapid, and there is symmetric generalized involvement with respiratory involvement in high cervical lesions. DTRs may not be present in the early phase, and then they can be present after the disease progresses. Sensory level usually present. There is early bladder bowel involvement, and you have fever at onset, meningeal signs occasionally, and preceding illness also can be seen. Post-traumatic neuritis, because it is seen limited to one limb. The others which have a rapid progression would include botulism, viral myositis, hypokalemic periodic paralysis, critical illness neuropathy. The important thing here is that botulism is a descending paralysis, whereas rest of them are ascending. And sensory features may be seen with botulism, fever at onset may be seen with viral myositis, and systemic features may be seen with critical illness neuropathy. Next, we come to the ones which have slightly slower progression and onset. So post-diphtheritic polyneuropathy, polio, non-polio enteroviruses, tick bite paralysis, and rabies. Again, the important thing here is that only post-diphtheritic polyneuropathy would be descending, rest would be ascending. And you may see sensory features in post-diphtheritic polyneuropathy and rabies. Bladder and bowel involvement can be seen in post-diphtheritic polyneuropathy and rabies. Fever may be seen with polio, non-polio enteroviruses, and rabies. Systemic features may be seen in most of them, so cardiomyopathy in post-diphtheritic polyneuropathy, a host of symptoms in polio, non-polio enteroviruses, and bite marks may be seen in rabies and tick bite. So you can have precipitating factors as well, like in diphtheria, you may see a bull neck, you may see an IM injection history in polio, non-polio, and then history of endemic area travel or animal bite in tick bite and rabies. Important thing is, in acute flaccid paralysis, it is not just taking history and examination, because it's a medical emergency, so the management also has to continue side by side. So one thing is respiratory care. Early respiratory support and intubation is crucial for final outcome. Then we have detection of bulbar weakness, management, then managing cardiovascular instability, because many of them are associated with autonomic disturbances, so one should not miss out on rhythm disturbances. Rule out dyselectrolytemia and snake envenomation, because it has treatment implications. Rule out spinal cord pathology, because one needs to give pulse steroid. And AFP surveillance, very important from epidemiological point of view, not to miss out on polio cases. One should also look at etiological clues like serum potassium for hypokalemic periodic paralysis. And then MRI may have to be done if you're suspecting a myelitis. Electrophysiology also has a role. Cerebrospinal fluid examination in GBS, one can see an albuminocytological dissociation, and it is usually seen beyond first week. And if there is pleocytosis, one should suspect some of the infective causes. CPK for viral myositis. If we are suspecting porphyria, urine porphobilinogen becomes important. If you're suspecting a heavy metal toxicity, then urine and serum toxicology screen becomes important. And Lyme serology if it's a relevant clinical scenario. So this particular slide actually summarizes whatever I have told till now. So you have a child with acute flaccid paralysis. We already know the definition. This can be the case scenarios. So if there is a sensory level, paraparesis and early bladder dysfunction, we think of transverse myelitis. If there is cranial neuropathy, respiratory and autonomic involvement, and features of peripheral neuropathy with or without bladder involvement, you have this huge group which has GBS, post-diphtheritic polyneuropathy, botulism, tick bite paralysis, critical illness neuropathy, hypokalemic paralysis, and similar cases. Then if you have fever and meningeal signs to begin with and asymmetric findings, you think in terms of non-polio enteroviral infection, preceding history of injection, obviously traumatic neuritis, and you have proximal weakness with or without systemic features, you think of muscle involvement in the form of polymyositis or viral myositis. Emergency care, once we are done with the emergency care, even definitive care is important in these cases. So this includes treatment options like IVIG, which is indicated in GBS and myasthenic crisis, pulse steroid therapy in transverse myelitis, anti-snake venom in suspected cases of envenomation, intravenous potassium for hypokalemia, and if we are suspecting a definite case of heavy metal toxicity, then chelation if indicated. Supportive care is equally important. One should know that position change, air-filled mattress is important for prevention of bed sores. Bladder bowel care has to be looked at. Clean intermittent catheterization should be done in cases of urinary retention. In cases of constipation, it should be managed accordingly. Proper calorie and protein intake is important, along with mineral and vitamin supplementation, because it helps in recovery. Then in cases of bulbar dysfunction, patients should be put on oral or nasogastric feeds, and physical and occupational therapy in the acute phase, stretching is advised to prevent development of contractures. However, if the acute phase sequelae sets in, detailed tailor-made to individual needs, physical and occupational therapy is advised. So the take-home messages are, it is defined by a clinical syndrome which is characterized by rapid onset of weakness, occasionally accompanied by bulbar and respiratory muscle weakness. Surveillance is and reporting is of significant epidemiological significance. The cause of AFP vary according to the age and geographical location of the patient and anatomical localization. Initial stabilization is crucial because it's a medical emergency. So respiratory, cardiac, and bulbar dysfunction should be ruled out immediately. And one should always rule out potentially treatable conditions like GBS, transverse myelitis, myasthenia, porphyria, heavy metal toxicity, dyselectrolytemia, and snake envenomation. A detailed history and clinical examination can provide clue to the underlying etiology in most of the cases. And apart from emergency and definitive care, supportive care is of utmost importance as a determinant of outcome in these children. Thank you so much.
Okay, so that brings us to the close of this session. And on behalf of all three of us, Professor Attisberia, Professor Puri, and myself, I thank Dr. Gulati and the organizers for asking us to be here. And all the speakers have done a very good job because they had a very limited time, but they gave you a lot of material in that limited time. So let's give them a big hand before we close. Thank you very much, Dr. Gulati.